You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand.
Hello! I'm so glad all of you are here today. I am just filled with excitement to be able to talk to y'all and to bring, I've been praying for weeks since I decided I was going to do this, but I pray that it's God's words, not mine, and I know he will do that. So I'm so glad y'all are here, as Kelly already said. Just want to tell you a little about myself. My name is Courtney, as you've already heard, and I am originally from Missouri. I'm a Midwestern girl, born and raised there, and I came to Texas by way of Texas A&M, Giggum Aggies. I went to school there, and I studied special education. That was my major in college, and it was in high school that I actually decided, I'm going to do special ed. That is my dream. That's my sweet spot. I know that's what I want to do, and I never changed my mind. So after school, I ended up, by the grace of God and his goodness, got a job student teaching, or I didn't get a job student teaching, I student taught, and then got a job at the school I student taught at, and so was able to stay in the Bryan College Station area for a couple years after graduation and taught life skills. So I taught, and then by another act of the Lord, I got to come to Faithbridge in the summer, August of 2015 is when I started on staff here. So that's just to give you a little background on me. For all of you who are here today, there are people who are trained in special ed or special education, special needs, something. There are people who are untrained. There are people who have experience. There are people that are not experienced. Some of you are parents or family member of a child who has a disability. And then some of you are just curious about what Open Gates is. And there are also people here who are already serving in Open Gates. My sweet servers are all here. They were greeting you as you came in, and we're at the side tables, so they're here. Whether you heard about this online, you saw the video. We played a video in service. If you got a mailed invitation or got an email, I'm so glad y'all are here. This is so fun. My heart is just filled with passion for this ministry, and I hope to be able to share that passion with you today. And I want to just bring you alongside me and tell you about the ministry, and I hope that you're impacted through your time here today. I hope that God uses this time to inspire you and get you excited like I am. So I want to pray over us, I'll pray over your meal too, but I'm going to pray before I get going. Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this day. Thank you for this time that we have to come together and talk about what you're doing, God. You are active, you're alive, and you're working, and it's so fun to see you move. I thank you for these people, that they took the time to be here today. God, your spirit is here. I know you're here. I don't even need to invite you here. You're here. You're already here. And I just love to see you move. So just be present in this time. Open hearts to hear your voice, God. Let your spirit be upon me, too. As I speak, let it be your words and not mine. We thank you for this time and pray all that in your name. Amen. So what is Open Gates? I'm just going to kind of break it down for you what it is. It's a ministry designed to love and to serve children, students, and families who've been impacted through disability in some way. It's an all-encompassing family ministry. We want to minister to whole families and be a source of hope for them. We want to encourage them in their walks with the Lord and just love to love on them when they're in our midst. Yes, it's a special needs ministry. That's our title, but that title has such depth to it, and I hope to share that with you today. Our desire, first and foremost, is to provide a safe, a loving, and a welcoming environment for people impacted through disability to come and learn about Jesus, not just to come learn about him when they're in our midst, but to have an experience for his love for them, to encounter him when they're here in our midst. We're here to assess the needs of people and to plan ahead to meet their needs when they're with us. Open Gates, as I mentioned, is an all-encompassing ministry for whole families. We want to minister to them and be a source of hope. And we want to seize the opportunity to walk alongside these families as they go through trials of life. We want to be that for them. So I want to tell you a little bit, I'm going to tell you a little story. When I was at Texas A&M, my church there, I would sit in service on Sundays, and I noticed this family. They would always sit in the same place every week, and the parents would take turns walking out with their little boy. They would take turns, and I just saw them constantly every week. That was the thing. And often the dad would leave, and he would just not come back in, and then they would switch. The next week, the mom would leave. They just knew when their little boy would hit his max, and they would leave. And I ended up getting to know the family a little bit, and they told me, like, our little boy, they had adopted him, but he had lots of sensory issues, and I don't think he had an official diagnosis at the time, but lots of behavioral stuff, and he couldn't go to Sunday school. He couldn't go. They, like, said, he can't come. I'm sorry, like, we don't know how to handle him. Sorry. So I was like, that is so sad to me. It's so sad. Because the church, out of all places, should be the place that gets to say yes. Like, we want them here. And so I asked them, I said, and I only did this a couple of times, but I said, can I sit with him in the back so y'all can just stay? And that's when my heart first felt burdened for this ministry. I said, this needs to be a place, church should be a place where families can come and we can say yes. Families who've been impacted through disability so often feel rejection, they feel rejection in all areas of life. They feel they stand out at school. They feel rejected and like they stand out in the grocery store and wherever they might be. That's a common thing. And I just feel so passionately that the church should not be the place where that's true too. It shouldn't. It should be different here. They have many wounds from the past, and I can't tell you how many families I've encountered since being in ministry, like here at Faithbridge, that have been rejected by other churches. That's a common thing, and it's no one's fault. Like, I think people are just learning, and that's part of the reason today I'm so excited, because I want y'all to know that this is a need. I want it to impact you, and you can spread the word. Like, we want to equip other people, other churches, to be able to do what we're doing. So these families, they feel exhausted, they feel isolated, they're grieving, and they are fearful of continued rejection. I want to take you, so I could talk about that all day long, but I want y'all to hear the stories of two of our sweet Open Gates families, the moms, and hear their story of how they came to Open Gates and how the ministry has impacted their lives and their families' lives.
A church should be a place where everyone can go and be comfortable and be loved and to hear from God, and we didn't have that because of the situation that my children were in. Churches couldn't take care of my children. They had special needs. So for years and years and years, we didn't have anywhere to go.
So before Chris and I were married, we actually went to a church, and so naturally when we had Bradley, we thought, okay, we'll start taking her to church, and She just didn't do well, even as a baby. We were always being called back. We decided that we would try to go to Easter with one of our friends, and she had a meltdown almost immediately. Before I even sat down in the chair, my number flashed up on the screen, and we went to the front desk, and she said, please, I can go back. I can do this. Like, I can handle it. And they told her no. They said, you can't. We're a safety risk, and you can't be here. And so we left, and at that point, we said, church is just not for us. And that's okay. We were okay with that, you know, because I was a strong enough Christian, and my husband and I, we had each other's backs, and we had friends. And so that was it. So when the same friends invited us to Faithbridge, she's like, no, we've had a really good experience here. Like, this is a great church. And I thought to myself, okay, you know, heard this before. And so, a couple weeks later, after she'd asked me a couple times, we went to Faithbridge. During the offering, I had seen that there was a place that said Open Gates on the back to learn about new ministries. And I was like, sure, I'll check that. And so I let it go with the offering. And then Courtney called me the next week, and we set up the shadow. And so every week since then, she's progressed. And she, like I said, sometimes she ends up in the STEM room, but we get to go to church, and I have never once been called to come and get her. Not once.
We actually went to Faithbridge on a tour, and it blew my mind. I was in tears. I was so nervous because I was still thinking, it's not gonna work out. Open Gates coordinator called me, and she did a really thorough research on our family. She asked about each child and what their needs were, what their likes were, what their dislikes were, and that was all to let the shadows know how to best help our children. And the shadows will come in and they'll know our children. They'll know how to see what their triggers are, how to remove them from a situation. And it gave me such comfort because we've never had anything like that.
We have 4.5-year-old sextuplets, 3 boys and 3 girls. I got a tip through a friend that Faithbridge has great VBS. So I signed up the 5 kids, and then when they called to make sure, I really had 5 kids born on the same day, and I said, I do, and I have a 6th one, but she has special needs, so I didn't sign her up, and that's how we learned more about Faithbridge and Open Gates. They immediately said, oh, it doesn't matter, she can come too.
Parents who have children with special needs, they don't think things are for them. They kind of think, that's cool for typical families, but we're atypical.
Open Gates is not just a ministry. These are people who care and love your child, and my daughter loves them.
It's more of a relationship and not just someone who's there to watch them. It's kind of like family.
I think we really wanted to stick around when her shadow Rhonda went on vacation in the summer and came back and was like, I missed her. I got so connected to her. I called to make sure they had her covered, and that just made us feel better. We're like, oh, okay, she's really attached. She really cares for her, and it's not just like, oh, I'm just here on Sunday just to watch this kid for an hour. Like, she really wanted to know about Leah and be involved, and if anything, she knows that's going on with Leah, doctor's appointments or any decisions we're making, she'll text me, just let me know she's been praying for her and what's going on. She wants an update.
I know that God has a way to reach them, and he's reaching those children. And the things that the shadows do and the things that Courtney does, they're saints. They're saints to allow the service for us. Otherwise, we wouldn't have this opportunity. And it's been a life changer to us because our children are getting closer to God.
she participates in all the things that the other children are doing. To have that kind of acceptance when you've been told so many times that you don't belong somewhere is pretty amazing.
I didn't have a church that I belonged to. Now I do. Now I have friends I can call and they know exactly what I'm talking about or exactly what I need, or I don't feel kind of awkward bringing up God. That is what Faithbridge does. It allows families who have children with special needs to go and to worship and to pour into their children.
She's in a loving environment where they talk about Jesus, and I don't think that can be replaced by anything.
I know you saw it there. I forgot to introduce them, but those moms are wonderful. Rebecca Wright has been here, like she said, since March, but Latoya Walker is here today. Rebecca couldn't be here today because she's a little one sick, but Latoya is over here, and she's actually going to be at the parent table in the back if any of y'all would like to talk to her after. She's wonderful and would love to tell you more about their experience here at Faithbridge. One of my favorite things in that video that was said was, well, I liked a lot of things about the video. I didn't cry this time. I used to cry. I watched it a lot of times before, but when Latoya said it's like family, it is like family. We are like family. Open Gates as a whole, like the shadows, the families, the kids, all of us, we're family. And that's what I love. I feel it. And it's all centered on Jesus. It is. It's wonderful. But as you can see, the Lord is moving here at Faithbridge, y'all. I feel so excited and humbled all at the same time that I get to be a part of this, that you guys get to be a part of this tremendous movement that's happening. And right now, like I said before, special needs ministries are a rarity among churches. They are, but the Lord is moving here. And I hope that one day, special needs ministries are the norm. It's the norm. It's at every church, everywhere. And all churches will have them. I want to thank the Lord, take this time to praise him and thank him for where Open Gates has been. I'm just going to take you through some of the highlights of last year, of 2016. We launched our first ever respite night, and that respite night we call Recess. And it's a once a month night where families get to come and drop off their kiddos with a disability and their siblings, and they get to go have date night or run errands or do something else and just not worry about their kids. So, and it's a party for us. We get to have fun with them and love on them in the name of the Lord. So Recess, we launched that last February. We also drew in 10 new families for us to love and serve on Sunday mornings. We recruited 13 new volunteers to serve as shadows, and some of you may have picked up on that now, but I call my volunteers who work with the kids who have a disability, I call them shadows, because they're their little shadows throughout the time that they're here. Growth in the ministry it required the need or brought the need to hire an associate to further what we're doing. So I have I had a helper, a part-time person. Now, where are we now? I'll bring you along and let you know kind of where we're at right now. We have 46 families on Sunday mornings that we serve. We have about 25 shadows on Sunday mornings that come and encourage kids and students. And just to give you an idea, about 80% of our participants in Open Gates are kids ministry. That's roughly the percentage I normally give, but just to give you an idea, 80% are kids. We have 9 moms. We have a really cool thing called Love Without Limits. It's a grow group specifically for moms of kids with disabilities, and there's 9 women in that group now, and they're growing. They have people visiting all the time. That's led by Heather Moshe, who's a mom in the ministry. So for the time being, we had to press, and actually this was a couple months ago this happened, we had to press pause on Recess. Reason being, we had the response we were having from people wanting to be a part of it was not proportionate to the number of servers that we had. We need more people. We need more people to come and stand behind it, stand with it, so we can withstand the response that we're getting from people. So it's on pause, and we're also doing some restructuring for that night to make it, again, more flow better, and I'll explain more of that in just a little bit. But that's where we're at now, and we hope, our plan is to bring it back, though. So just so y'all know, we're bringing it back. It's coming back, and it's going to be better than ever. I'm so excited. So we're in a season of recruiting with that, as I mentioned. We're in a season of recruiting, heavy recruiting. We need additional servers to carry out the tasks in all ministry areas. And that's on Sunday mornings, too. We need people on Sunday mornings. And right now, I'm also on the lookout for a summer intern. If any of y'all know someone who's in college and looking for a job for the summer, it is a paid position, spread the word. Tell them to get in touch with me. They can call the front desk at the church, and they'll send them on to me, but we would love to have that that position. On another note, I'm like so excited right now to get to share this, but last week I hired an Open Gates associate. We hired a new person for that position, and I would love her to stand up, Miss Julie Bradford. If you'll just wave. Yay. I'm so excited that the Lord brought her here. I love her heart, y'all. Her heart for God is so pure and so genuine. She is, and she's been a server in kids ministry for like 8 years or something. They've known her. Kelly's known her forever. She's a hard worker. She's a diligent worker. I'm like beyond excited. And y'all, something that's so special, I hope it's okay that I share this, but Julie is a parent of a child with a disability. Her sweet girl, Olivia, has autism, and she has the experience, y'all. It's going to be so fun to work together, and I'm just so excited to be a team with you. She's hopefully starting this week, so I'm pumped. So dreams for the future. I want to talk about what's in store, what's ahead of us, now that we've praised God for what's in the past and what's happening now. We're working on a lot of these right now as we speak. We've been working for months on restructuring recess and thinking of a better way to execute that night. And for Sunday mornings, what positions I need filled in order to make sure we really are caring for our kids the best that we can and having people, a reserve of shadows, to be there in case visitors come or more kids come or extra kids who have just more behavioral needs, we can step in and serve them. So we're in a recruiting season, as I mentioned, and I don't know, y'all, I don't know what God has in store. I don't know what he has in store, but me, along with the other staff around me and lots of other supporters of Open Gates, I'm praying and asking God to show us where he wants it to go. And I know he is leading us, and he has led us, and he will continue to be faithful to guide us. A dream of mine is to also be able to equip other churches. I want other churches in our area to be knowledgeable about this ministry, and hopefully I can give them the tools, the things that we've learned here at Faithbridge. And the people who were before me, they've learned and passed on to me that we can pass on to them in order to bring these ministries. And so it will be the norm. That's what we want to do. I would love to reach out to our adult community more. I would love to have a Bible study for them. And again, these are just dreams. These are just my dreams. But I feel that they're going to happen. I'd love to have an adult small group, like I mentioned, and serve opportunities for adults. I would love to have more opportunities for families to fellowship with one another and kind of foster those opportunities for them. At one recess, a group of our parents went to dinner that night, and they love that. They get each other. They want to be together. They want to build community with each other. So I want to hopefully foster more opportunities for that. I want to be more diligent and focused on training my servers and equipping them in order to serve the kids the best that they can. We're going to come back with recess. We're going to come back with respite nights, which is recess. And I'd also like to extend that invitation to community members and invite people in to be a part of it and make it an outreach thing so people from the community can come and be a part of it. Another big thing, some of y'all here today are members of the Woodlands campus, Faithbridge in the Woodlands. We want to expand the ministry there, y'all. We want to have a group of shadows up there that can be there ready for kids to come and believing that they will come. So that's kind of the dreams. So some of you may be asking, what does this mean? What do I do now? What do I do? how can I be an impact and make an impact and be part of God's plan? I want to, two of my wonderful shadows who are here today, Kelly Clark and Rhonda Davis, have shared a little bit about their experience as a shadow, as a server, a volunteer in Open Gates, and I want to let them tell you about what it's like to be a server in Open Gates.
My name is Rhonda Davis, and I have been at Faithbridge for about 6 years. My husband Jay and I have 5 children. We are empty nesters, so we are enjoying our empty nest.
My name is Kelly Clark, and I've been at Faithbridge, I think, since 2010. I'm married to Chad Clark, and we have a 5-year-old daughter by the name of Zona.
When Jay and I did the Faithbridge 101 class, and they were setting us up in a small group, and then giving us areas that we could serve in, when I first heard Open Gates and heard about the program, I immediately knew that was something that I wanted to do, being a teacher and my love of children.
I first heard about Open Gates when, I mean, actually right when we started at Faithbridge. And I remember God like tugging on my heart to do that. And I thought, oh, I'm not gonna do it right now, you know? And then I think it was VBS, I volunteered and I did Open Gates. And I was scared, I was nervous, but I just, you know, said, God, just show me. And once I got past that one child and that hurdle, then it just became like, I can do this.
I started working in Open Gates of April of this year. So, and then I did VBS for the Woodlands and Klein, and that was when I met Leah. Courtney told me all about her, and she said, I think you're going to be a perfect match. So I was a little nervous, not knowing what to expect.
Being at Open Gates has made me realize that there were all the children were made in the perfect way of God, and they just need to be loved. I know, you know, my big thing was I just want these parents to be able to go to church. When I first, I'd mentor LJ once, and then Latoya and I met for lunch, and we hit it off right off the bat, but I remember asking her, you know, I said, well, where'd y'all go to church before? And she just welled up with tears, and she said, what church would take 3 kids with autism?
I guess it was the first time that I sang to her. And her face just lit up, and she smiled at me. And she would lean back and just look at me, and it just, so much joy in my heart for this little girl. And it made me joyful to know that she felt safe and she felt happy, you know, while I was taking care of her. After that, it was just, there was no turning back. So I've requested, ever since then, I requested her every Sunday. So it's, she's mine on Sundays while her parents can go to church and worship.
You know, all week they have to go to school and they have to, you know, be a certain way and sit there. And on Sunday, it's to allow them to be them, but to still learn about God. When they can repeat back, I mean, especially, say, LJ, that might not, I don't feel like he's listening at times, but then they ask questions at the end and he can answer every single question. And that, to me, is amazing. Just because they might have sensory issues or nonverbal or need to yell out, doesn't matter. I mean, I feel that way at times. I mean, it's that they don't have that filter, and you know what? Sometimes that's okay, because they're the most loving and just wonderful kids around. They really are.
They're the heroes, y'all. They're on the front lines every week. They're the heroes, and they're making the impact for these kids. They love them so well. I feel so blessed that I know. I was gonna cry. I know all the people I know who are part of Open Gates. They're so wonderful. They are the heroes, and they love the family so well, too. They've built these relationships with them, y'all. It's beautiful. I love watching it. So one of the things I was thinking, both of them, a commonality between Kelly and Rhonda, they both had some fear involved. They were fearful, like, I'm not trained in special education or special needs in any way. I know nothing. I don't have any experience in working with people with disabilities, anything like that. But my answer to that and to them was, that's okay. It's okay. Our job when they're here is to love them and to keep them safe, obviously. But I will equip you, we will equip you to be able to care for them well and give you the tools and the knowledge that you need in order to facilitate their inclusion and to just be a good support for them. You, each one of you, can be a part of the solution, just like those ladies were. We can change the story of disability in our community, in the world, all over. But you just have to have courage. You just have to have courage and believe that God is going to equip you and be, and I'm going to equip you, but God, first and foremost, Him, He's going to be there with you, leading you. There's a verse in Luke 4:18 I'm going to share with you. The Spirit of the Lord, and this is Jesus speaking, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to captives and recovering the sight of the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. Y'all, we have a different answer because we have a relationship with Christ. He is our ultimate model, and if we're following Him, we can do this. We can love people in His name. We can do it. I'm going to break down for you a little bit the specific opportunities to become involved within Open Gates. And I'm going to start with families and talk about family involvement. First of all, for families and children, the opportunities are Sunday morning. This is one. At 9 and 11 o'clock service, we have kids ministry and student ministry programming at both services. So your kids can come and be a part of the services just along with their grade level peers and participate in the lessons with them. And then our other opportunity that's coming back soon is recess. That's a first Friday. It happens the first Friday of every month. And so that's another opportunity. And then the Grow Group for Moms. That's a great support system. And I actually have little information cards on that Grow Group in the back at the information table for families and parents if you want to learn more about when they meet. Now, serve opportunities within Open Gates. I'm going to start with Sunday mornings. Sunday mornings, you can be a shadow. You can fill the shadow role, which is, again, the one-on-one support for a child with a disability or a child with a need for behavioral redirection. Shadow coaches, this is a new role that a lot of you haven't heard. Even my current people haven't heard this. So I've been talking to them for a while. This is the restructuring. You're going to start hearing the new things now, the new roles we have to fill to make the ministry most effective. So shadow coaches, that's another role. And I'm going to tell y'all, I'm not going to go into much detail about each of these now. We put together a pamphlet in the back at the shadow information, server information table with each role broken down, and there's a description behind each one. So if you want to learn more, you can go back and read the detailed description. Open Gates Room Post, that's something we do have now, but we're going to recruit just for that position. For recess, we're going to have security and welcome. We already had security, but we're going to have a welcome team, so someone to greet the families as they come in. We're going to have a hospitality and food team who serves our meal to the shadows, to the servers, before the families arrive. Station leaders in each room, that's a new one we're going to do. It's going to be really fun. We're going to have a nurse, just like we've always had a medical professional on site that can keep the kids safe and be there in case an emergency arises and we need them to step in. We're going to have a curriculum planner, so someone who has experience in planning lessons and getting together biblically based Bible teaching for the kids. We're going to have a material prep team, so that's more of a weekday thing, people cutting out the materials for crafts and just preparing different things for the night. Shadows, as I've already mentioned a million times before, shadows will be there. We've got to have the shadows. We're going to have shepherds now. Those of you who are familiar with kids ministry, they have shepherds on Sunday mornings, and shepherds are a leader of a group of about 6 to 8 typically functioning children. And so we're going to have those for the siblings at recess because the siblings get to come too. Open Gates Room Post, that position will still be there. We're going to have a setup team that comes early before recess and helps us just set up because that takes a long time. And there's lots that needs to be done, and we do decorations for each one. It's really fun, so we need a team for that. And then this is a new one, too. We're going to have recess runners is what I'm going to call them, but they're 7th and 8th grade in high school, too, if you would rather. If high school students can shadow, but 7th and 8th grade can't, so this is a role for them. We're just going to have a few of them, each one, but to run around and get snacks, get their drinks for the kids, just run around and do the odds and end tasks that we need done for that night. Last section is weekday roles. We have roles to be filled on weekdays. First of all, we have Wednesday night Bible study groups that meet here at the church. We have Curious, which is our 6th, 7th, and 8th grade Bible studies. And then we also, for a season of the year, have 4th and 5th grade Bible studies. Is that right? Is there 3rd grade? Just 4th and 5th grade that meet on Wednesday nights. And there are kids that come that could use a shadow. So we need people on Wednesday nights to come and support them and support, help them be included with their group and give them a break if they need to, walk out with them. So that's a need. Point Break is our high school ministry here at Faithbridge, and they meet on Sunday nights here at the church. We need shadows for that. And y'all, this is what I'm thinking, like, our kids are 80% right now who are in kids ministry. They're growing up. They're not going to be in kids ministry forever. So we've got to think forward to the future. We're going to need shadows all throughout. We're going to need them. So Sunday nights, Point Break meets. And then also a huge need is women's ministry shadows on Thursday mornings. Thursday mornings are our women at Faithbridge meet. And we have kids programming for preschool age kids that day, and we need shadows for that. There's lots of need for people to come and be a part of that. So as you can see, we have many, many, many roles that need to be filled. And I don't want anyone to feel intimidated or kind of just taken aback. I understand there are different time constraints. Each of you have different time constraints, different skill sets. Some of you have weekday availability only, like no weekends. That's okay. God can use you. He can use every one of you here and to be a part of Open Gates. I want to close with a passage of scripture from Luke 14. And I'm just going to read it. It's a parable of the great banquet. I'm going to read it to you. Then Jesus said to his hosts, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, invite the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." So God, this is what God wants. This is what he wants us to do. He wants us to invite them in. He says, these are the people that I want, the lame, the crippled, the blind, the poor. And then I'm going to skip down. There's another section to that, but I'm going to skip down. So he sends a servant out to start inviting more people to come. And he ends up getting responses from all these people that they're rejected. They're like saying, "I'm too busy. I got this going on. And then he says, the servant came back and reported to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, "Go out quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame." "Sir," the servant said, "what you ordered has been done, but there's still room." Then the master told his servant, "Go out into the roads of the country and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full." This is God's house. We want to fill God's house. We want to fill Open Gates with his people. We've got to go out, though. We've got to bring them in. We've got to compel them to come here and tell them they have a place. We are the servants. We're the servants he's telling to go and get them. That's us. Our church, the churches in general, is not complete. We're not complete without the disenfranchised and the vulnerable people. We need to go out and bring them in. Our God has a heart that is drawn to people who are cast aside, who are forgotten and rejected. When Jesus walked this earth, that is who he gravitated toward. He gravitated toward people like that. He sought them out and he initiated with them. He reminded them of their place in his kingdom and the value that they possess as his children. As Christ followers, we are to carefully study and attempt and strive to emulate the person of Christ. That's what we're to do. So I hope you feel inspired by this and are spurred on to action. Speaking of action, I want to bring you up to speed on action steps now, what I want you to do. So I'm going to address each category of people that might be here. Current Open Gates servers, this is specifically for you. I want you to be on your knees. I want you to pray about where God has you. I want you to pray what he's leading you to. When you look, I want you to grab one of those brochures from the back, read through the roles. I want you to fill out a blue card on the table. I know y'all are like, I'm already serving. I still want you to rethink through where God has you. If he wants you Sundays, weekdays, recess, all of them, I want you to fill out the blue card and turn it in before you leave. So just pray and think through where he has you. For new people who are interested in serving in some capacity, I want you, before you leave, there are blue, they're actually white cards, but they have a blue Open Gates stamp on the top of them. Fill out that card, and there's going to be people at the back, the two back doors with baskets. Please put them in there before you leave, and we'll get in touch with you this week. So fill out those cards. Visit the back table. I'm going to have representatives back there to talk with you. If you have questions, I'll be around too. I'd love to talk to you. But be sure to fill those out. And if you're serious and really want to get the process started, I have volunteer applications back there and background check forms. I also made a checklist of the steps involved in becoming a server, so you can pick that up so then you know exactly you got to do this. So go ahead and grab that. For current Open Gates families who are here, continue to spread the word to others. Continue to pray for the future of this ministry and get excited for what's to come, because there's exciting things in store. For families interested in learning more, or just people here from the community that are interested in learning more, fill out a green information card and I will get in contact with you this week. And also visit, I have another table in the back that's specifically for parents or other people wanting to learn more about the ministry. So you can fill out the green card, turn that in, and then visit the back table and talk with the ladies back there. Please share, and this is to everyone, please share what you heard here today. Spread the word. Tell more people about what God's doing and invite them in. Invite them in. I'd love to meet them, to set up a tour with them or anything. Like, I want to meet new people. And please pray. I think we need God. We need God. And when we're on our knees asking him to help us, that's the best place. So it's the best place to be. So please pray with me. And actually, we're going to pray for real right now. Please pray, but we're going to pray before we head out. If you bow your heads with me. Dear Lord, I thank you for this time. I love that we had this opportunity to be together in your name. God, I ask that you would move hearts, continue to move hearts, and draw them in. You pave the way for the future of this ministry, God, so we trust you with that. We trust you. You're good, and we know you have a good plan. So go before us, God. Pave the way. We're dependent on you. We need you, God. Thank you for smiling down on us. Thank you for being here today. We love you in your name. Amen.